All right, what's going on, guys? Today we're going to be looking at another World Championship winning deck. This time we're going to be looking at Mono Blue Tinker. This deck won the 2000 World Championship, and standard at the time was composed of the Urza block, the Mercadian Masks block, and 6th edition. And this time, the deck would be piloted by Jon Finkel. So in order to understand how this deck worked, first we have to look at how it generated mana, because this was a big mana deck. This deck worked by generating tons of mana with a few mana rocks, and then it used that to do some very nasty things. So first off, it ran 4 each of Thran Dynamo, Grim Monolith, and Metalworker. So all of these just do one thing, they add mana. Thran Dynamo, 4 mana, tap it to add 3. Grim Monolith, 2 mana, it adds 3 as well, though it comes with a drawback in which it can't untap, and you have to pay 4 to untap it. And then Metalworker, it's a 3 mana 1/2 creature, but you can tap it, reveal any number of artifact cards from your hand, and add 2 mana for each card revealed. So if you just have, let's say, 3 artifact cards in your hand, totally reasonable, this thing can tap for 6 mana for a 3 mana investment, so pretty crazy. So the idea here, obviously, is just to put out a bunch of mana really quick. But what really made this crazy is the inclusion of Voltaic Key. So this allows you to untap an artifact for 1 mana. That means that, you know, it's not unreasonable to, let's say, turn 1 Voltaic Key, turn 2 Grim Monolith, tap it for 3, use one of that to use the key to untap it, add 3 more, you have 5 now. You could play a Thran Dynamo then, which you can then in turn tap that for 3 for a Metalworker. I mean, obviously that's kind of, it's never going to scale quite like that. But the idea here, you can just flood the board with these mana rocks, and with Voltaic Key constantly untapping them, you can just put out so much mana so quick. And Metalworker with Voltaic Key is just insane. I mean, again, if you just have 3 artifacts in your hand, that's not unreasonable at all. I mean, that's tapping for 12 mana. You know, you tap it, add 6, use Voltaic Key, untap it, and then tap it for another 6. That's just completely insane. So that's what the deck did. It used just these mana rocks to put out tons and tons and tons of mana. Now, what it did with that is kind of interesting. So first off, the most simplistic route would just be a Phyrexian Colossus. It ran one of these. Phyrexian Colossus is a 7 mana 8/8. And it has kind of like super menace in which it can't be blocked except by 3 or more creatures. It does have a pretty big drawback in that you have to pay 8 life to untap it. But with Voltaic Key, you can untap it for 1 mana, not a big deal. And you know, your opponent's going to die pretty quick. So that's kind of the simplistic, you know, just put a big old giant creature in play and start swinging with it. But there's a more interesting thing in the form of Phyrexian Processor. This is a 4 mana artifact that when it comes into play, you can pay any amount of life, and then you can pay 4 and tap it to put a minion token in play that has power and toughness equal to the amount of life you paid. So if you pay 10 life, you can put a 10-10 black minion into play for 4 mana. And then remember, with Voltaic Key, we can potentially activate this multiple times. Not to mention the fact that you can potentially get this out easily on turns, you know, 2, 3, 4 or so. Literally just pay 10, 15 life, and then start flooding the board with a bunch of just big, giant creatures that are pretty much impossible to stop. It is dangerous, obviously, if you dump a bunch of life into it, and then it gets destroyed, then you're in trouble. But since it's an artifact, and it can't tap the turn it comes into play, you could potentially, you know, generate tons of mana with Metalworker, play it, pay, you know, you could literally pay 19 life on turn 2 or 3, and then start putting out just, you know, 19-19s like crazy. And that'll end the game very quickly. Another thing that the deck can do is play a Masticore. It ran 4 of these. It's a 4 mana 4/4. Nothing too crazy. You do have to discard a card at the beginning of your upkeep. But you can pay 2 to deal 1 damage to target creature. And with all the mana that you're generating, you can basically just wipe your opponent's board out. Works really well with Phyrexian Colossus because it has to be blocked by 3 or more creatures. So if you can just wipe your opponent's board out, not only can Masticore potentially just end the game after a few turns, but with a Phyrexian Colossus, it's just another way to wipe your opponent's board and just, you know, wipe your opponent out with a few big creatures. So that's totally possible as well. And that's basically the core of the deck. It's, you know, Voltaic Key, with mana rocks like Grim Monolith and Metalworker, and then something like Phyrexian Processor, Masticore, or Phyrexian Colossus. That's what you're looking to do every single game. Flood the board with mana rocks, produce tons of mana, put something really, really big in play that your opponent can't deal with. It's pretty simple, but it's also a little bit janky, right? Like, how can you do that reliably every single game? It seems like something that a janky casual player would put together. But what really made this consistent, where the deck gets its name, is Tinker. The deck played 4 Tinkers, also 4 Brainstorms, which, you know, that's a classic. I think we all know what that does. But Tinker is a 3-mana sorcery that allows you to sacrifice an artifact to search your library for any artifact and put it into play. That's into play, not into your hand, and it doesn't come into play tapped either. So that means you can do one of 2 things with this. You can just search for a Phyrexian Colossus, for example, and you have an 8-8 on turn 3. It also allows you to get a Phyrexian Processor out, pretty much guaranteed on turn 3, bare minimum, because you're playing 4 copies of Phyrexian Processor, 4 copies of Tinker. And that's just kind of crazy. It's pretty much impossible to deal with at the time. If you've got 3, 4, 10-10s out on turn 3 or 4, I mean, that's pretty much the game. And, you know, hey, it's a world championship deck for a reason. This thing won the world championship, and this is pretty much why. Phyrexian Processor just coming out way faster than it should, and having Voltaic Key to untap it, to activate it multiple times, while producing tons and tons of mana, and it could just overwhelm opponents super quick. It also ran 1 copy of Crumbling Sanctuary and 1 copy of Mishra's Helix. So Crumbling Sanctuary is kind of interesting. It can save you from dying because it basically triples your life total. Mishra's Helix basically allows you to lock your opponent out of the game because you have so much mana, you're producing so much mana with all of your mana rocks that you can just tap down all of your opponent's lands at the beginning of their upkeep and they can just do nothing basically. And with Tinker, 1 copy is fine. You can get those whenever you need them. And then finally, the deck ran 4 copies of Tanglewire, which is kind of interesting. Like, this deck already seemed kind of obscene enough as it is. But Tanglewire has Fading 4, and at the beginning of each player's upkeep, that player taps an untapped artifact, creature, or land for each fade counter on it. So this is just another way to basically lock your opponent out of the game. If you get this out on turn, say, 2 with the help of a Grim Monolith, basically your opponent's going to be stuck tapping all of their lands. But since you have Mana Rocks in play, if you have Thran Dynamos, if you have Metalworker, you still have access to mana, whereas your opponent is just kind of stuck. So, it's kind of a way to lock your opponent out of the game. Just when you thought this was kind of stupid, with, you know, just putting out tons of mana and overwhelming your opponent with giant creatures. Oh, by the way, it can also just lock you down. So, yep, that's a thing that it can do. And that's the deck. That's all it does. Yep, we'll take a quick look at the mana base. It played 4 Crystal Veins, 4 Rashadan Ports, which is just another way to lock your opponent out of mana, and 4 Surprising Scaries, and then just 9 Islands. Yep, super simple. Nothing complex about that at all. And a super quick look at the sideboard, because I don't want to focus too much on this, because it requires, you know, an understanding of the metagame and what was being played at the time. But it played Annul and Chill, so you have a response to artifacts and enchantments, and you can just hate on red all day. It played Rising Waters, which is kind of interesting because it has kind of a Tanglewire aspect in which lands don't untap, and then at the beginning of each player's upkeep, they could untap a single land, which for your opponent, that's going to be devastating, but for you with Thran Dynamos and Metalworkers and whatnot, not a big deal, especially if you also have Voltaic Keys. That 1 mana that you're untapping each turn can go towards activating a Voltaic Key. So, you know, if you have a Thran Dynamo, even if you have just a Thran Dynamo, you have 6 mana per turn, whereas your opponent has a single 1 land untapping each turn. So, kind of funny. Also, Miscalculation, you know, just another counterspell against combo decks and whatnot. And then it also ran an additional copy of Mishra's Helix, just in case that's necessary. And that's it. That is the entire deck. Really simple. Really, really simple. Play mana rocks, produce tons of mana, and then do really big things. It's kind of crazy. It's kind of janky, actually. It's kind of funny that the World Championship deck was kind of the silly, janky kind of mana ramping deck. But there it is, guys. I mean, it seems silly, it seems janky, but at the same time, just Phyrexian processor was just crazy. It could put out such big creatures so quickly. And then when you're, you know, playing Tango Wires and stuff like that, so your opponent can't untap stuff, it's just, it's kind of crazy. Tinker too. Tinker is what made it so consistent. You always had access to whatever you were missing, whatever, you know, like this deck was capable of putting out these crazy kind of nut draws where you're just, you know, you draw these perfect hands where you can just, you know, it's kind of like Dredge now where, you know, Dredge doesn't do what Dredge does every single game. You know, it has those crazy draws where it puts out tons of damage super quick. But other times, you know, it kind of stutters. This is just, Tinker is what made this deck, you know, always have just a crazy draw. Because you have all your pieces, you can do all this crazy stuff. And then you have four copies of a card that can just become anything in the deck. And just allow you to just go off every single game, pretty much. It's kind of a janky, kind of silly deck. But with Tinker, you're kind of just guaranteed to always get to where you want to be. It's just a matter of how long it's going to take. Maybe it takes two or three turns, maybe it takes four or five. But you know you're going to get there, and then once the deck starts going, it's just kind of crazy. So, yeah, there you go, guys. That is Mono Blue Tinker, the 2000 World Championship winning deck, piloted by Jon Finkel. So, there you go. Now you're familiar with another deck from Magic the Gathering's history. Thanks for watching. I hope you found this interesting. And I will see you guys in the next one.